Welcome to the Renaissance and welcome to another edition of Arochukwu Never Conducted Slave Raids, Part 2. And this very important notice to you, our dear viewer, that it is never our intention to offend anyone with our videos. It is not also our intention to suggest, insinuate, or preach hate towards any group, race, tribe, or person. There is also no propaganda or any deliberate attempt to misinform anyone with our videos. Please look for the books, journals, magazines, or other publications or sources referenced and study them yourself. Remember, if you are not careful, the newspapers will have you hating the people who are being oppressed and loving the people who are doing the oppressing. Malcolm X. And from Elijah Muhammad, the Negro wants to be everything but himself. He wants to integrate with the white man, but he cannot integrate with himself or with his own kind. The Negro wants to lose his identity because he does not know his own identity. And at least today, you can at least see that he wants to become Aborigine. He wants to become Indian and continues to lose his identity. And here is a shout out to our donors. We appreciate them, and please remember that even if we do not announce them here, it does not mean we did not receive them or we do not appreciate them. It's simply to avoid the trolls and our detractors who come in to distract everyone. But we appreciate them and we say thank you very much. And in the same vein, with regard to our comments and our replies to comments on the channel, you may have noticed that YouTube is heavily censoring our comments as well as yours. So just bear in mind that when you don't see our comments, it does not mean we ignored you or we didn't reply to them. It simply means we may have responded, but they were removed. So you can see the likes of Stacey Stevens, who certainly must be a troll, working with the slave master in one way or another. You notice that her comments are coming through, even as they make no sense at all. And so in one of these her comments, she responded to where we told her that she was making a mockery of herself, and she replied, "I am not making a mockery of myself. Look at where you live and tell me it's better than America. Lie if you want to." And then we responded by posting the links where Malcolm X told us about the house Negroes and the field Negroes, and of course YouTube removed them. So we tried to respond again severally, and each time they were removed. So as at now, that comment does not have a reply unless YouTube has restored them as we're making this video. But that's by the way, so you understand what is happening, and it's incumbent upon you to now verify the facts yourself, to understand that the reason they are censoring the comments is because they don't want you to know the truth. But they are not censoring those that are claiming that the Negroes are now Indians or Aborigine. So you need to bear in mind that the slave master is a subtle beast. So he is able to recruit some gullible folks and pliable folks to work for him. So that's why you see that her comments come through and yours may not come through. And ours are not coming through either. And you can also see someone who observed it as well, says Teresa Abdul. Yes, comments are not being allowed on your channel, except for useless ones like Stacey Stevens, who happens to be obsessed with the Renaissance channel, because she keeps making comments that are not even related to what we're discussing here. And as you would expect, YouTube allows those ones because they do not make sense and may not teach you anything useful or sensible as regards who you are as a Negro. And in order to better appreciate why they are doing what they are doing, remember, their plan is to change the identity of the Negroes. So if they can change them to become Indian, then gradually they will be wiped off the map. Only Indians will be left. Nobody will even remember that the slave trade even happened or that a race like that ever existed. That's ideally what they plan to do, which we shall show you in a different video. But then, if you were to look at videos like Kurimuyo Meditations, you can look at it on your screen and then look for it on YouTube. We want you to watch it to see how the slave master lies brazenly through his brainless foot soldiers. Remember, he normally does not start the lies himself because he knows how ludicrous they look, but he also understands that the Negro listens to what Massa is saying. If you started saying tomorrow that Negroes were called something like any rubbish you like, just concoct any word and start saying it, you will see that some Negroes will start buying into it. These are some of the secrets of the slave master. So he has obviously commissioned these guys, like people like this Stacy you are seeing here, the likes of Dan Calloway, the likes of Professor Gates, to start saying whatever they are saying. We shall make a mind map to show you ideally where the whole thing will culminate, to show you that the slave master is never smart. He is only as smart as you think he is. But the moment you abandon his lies and face facts, you will discover that the slave master is never smart. He's just a subtle beast. So please watch the one that says, from indigenous American to African American, anthropology, oldest bones found, historic and all that. The reason we want you to watch all of them is so that you see how the lies work. You see how the slave master lies brazenly. And here is the guy that makes those videos. He is obviously an Indian or some other thing, but certainly not a Negro. But you see how they are trying to blend the Negro identity with the Indian identity, match them together, and of course carry on with their eugenics and all that. But our interest is for you to take your time, apply common sense to the narrative, look at historical records. You will see that the slave master is just a liar. And when you are done watching the from Native American to African American, please also watch where he now started claiming that white servitude and free Negro masters. So this is where they're trying to claim that the Negroes also enslaved them. Remember, all this is for the slave master to run away from his atrocities. So now they want to now start claiming that the Negroes also enslaved them too. You need to understand the game. When they start the lie, it doesn't make sense initially, but they know how to propagate it to a level that whoever says is a lie now looks as if he is a conspiracy theorist or whatever they choose. That's how he works. Remember when they started this Aborigine and Niji crap, we also told you that they are all working for the slave master, from Kurimu Ahayo to Dan Calloway to Professor Gates. Those are slave masters' foot soldiers. They have been conditioned to propagate those lies. The reason they look the way they look, like you will think they are so-called African Americans, is because the slave master understands that if he was to sell those dummy himself, if he was to tell those lies himself, the Negro will not buy into it because he is already a suspect. So he has to look from somebody that looks like the Negro and use that person to propagate those lies. He has done it several in the past, so you don't need to believe us. All you need to do is to look at the past. Then you can listen to Malcolm X here and you will understand what we're saying, and ask yourself, even with the video, even with what Malcolm is saying, they will still tell you that Malcolm claimed that they are not Africans. That's who they are. The reason they are bold enough to do all that and tell all those lies is because they know that the Negro listens to what Massa is saying, which is unfortunate, especially those still under the yoke. That's one thing you have to bear in mind.
African Americans, who are so-called Negro, one of the reasons that it is bad for us to continue to just refer to ourselves as so-called Negro, that's negative. When we say so-called Negro, that's pointing out what we aren't, but it isn't telling us what we are. We are African, and we happen to be in America. We're not American. We are people who formerly were Africans who were kidnapped and brought to America. Our forefathers weren't the Pilgrims. We didn't land on Plymouth Rock. The rock was landed on us. We were brought here against our will. We were not brought here to be made citizens. We were not brought here to enjoy the constitutional gifts that they speak so beautifully about today. And because we weren't brought here to be made citizens today, now that we've become awakened to some degree and we begin to ask for those things which they say are supposedly for Americans, they look upon us with hostility and unfriendliness. So our unwanted presence, the fact that we are unwanted, is becoming magnified in all of America's preachments today.
And before we delve into our topic of today, you may remember from our series on Biafra history and the slave trade, we showed you a map that showed a different location for Biafra. For some reason, we are not sure why, but we like to present these facts that we encounter in our researches so that other people can look at them too. So you see that in Negroland, you will see Biafra and Biafra up above Benin instead of underneath Benin. We are not sure what games the slave master was playing here. Initially, we thought it was an error, but in our further research, we tried to look at the slave master, like we told you about this, their plandemic, that if you wanted to understand anything about it, look at their foot soldiers. If you also want to understand things about whatever is going on there, be it Biafra, Ambazonia, and all those things, you just need to look at the slave master. His body language, his utterances, and the responses from his brainless foot soldiers will give him away. So, from this map, we now saw a letter. So let us quickly reference a newspaper publication of the 60s from the Daily Telegraph, London, England, November 12, 1968, issue 35317, and the author was A. V.H. Abakuk, and a map shows Biafra in modern Biafra. Now remember that this Biafra spelling, you notice, is totally different from the one they now claimed was from Mafra or whatever they chose. Our interest is for you to see that the slave master is behind all the problems you're seeing there. He knows that his foot soldiers, they lack humanity, they lack common sense. You can imagine where somebody can give you guns to be killing your siblings and you are doing it with pride. So our interest is for you to see the content of this letter and relate it with the map we showed you on your screen. And the letter says, map shows Biafra in modern Biafra. Now you notice the spelling was different from the one of Biafra. So if you were to go research further, you will see that that thing they claim in Wikipedia, that the name was coined by the Portuguese from Biafra or Mafra in Portugal, you will see is a lie. You will also notice that the slave master must have added it at some point, because he has to concoct a lot of things. He has to continue lying to sustain his subjugation of the Negroes in that area. You just need to bear this in mind. Without his brainless foot soldiers, there is not much he can do. So he goes further to say, sir, since in your columns, November 6 in bracket, Mr. Peter Dawson has accused me of engaging in historical and ethnographical misrepresentation and of basing moral assertions on cartographical error, I should be grateful if you would afford me an opportunity of refuting these charges. Now, please remember, this is as regards the Biafra-Nigerian War of 1967 to 70, where the slave master, hiding behind his slave hunting partners, unleashed a terror unknown to any other human type on earth on the Negroes at that time. So this is a letter. Somebody obviously called them to some moral questions and told them that Biafra existed. And remember, at that time, the BBC was the official propaganda channel to Nigeria, because Nigeria was actually a British property. It's actually a company. They were the slave traders. They now metamorphosed into some commercial ventures, which is subject of a different video. So anything that is happening there, you just have to know it is the slave masters. They are foot soldiers. They don't manufacture anything known to man. So all they know is they give them guns, give them bombs, and ask them to bomb. You can't even talk about it. But then, to show you that they lack both humanity and common sense, the same people will wake up and tell you that you are their brother. But then, going forward, it says, Mr. Dawson states on his reading of a map of 1815 that the old kingdom of Biafra lay in the neighborhood of Lake Chad. Thomas Bowen's map in Middleton's Complete System of Geography, published some 30 years before Mr. Dawson's map, shows Biafra in modern Biafra, the Igbo homeland. To the north of Biafra was the kingdom of Midian, capital Midra, and to the north of this again, the kingdom of Bono. Now remember, the slave master destroyed most of those kingdoms with his slave raids and then remodeled it in such a way that you will think those things are countries today. They are just slave farms, which we shall explain to you in a subsequent video. He's still using his brainless foot soldiers, things like the Nigerian army, things like the police. Remember, the Negroes never had a standing army. They had no need for it, which we shall look at in a subsequent video. But then the slave master brought all his evils with him and then tries to pretend to be the good guy. Remember, their atrocities and the lack of humanity amongst his brainless foot soldiers rubs off on all of us. That's why Africa is seen the way it's seen. So when they kill people, you will think it's all of us, whereas it was the slave hunters of old doing exactly what they were doing in the past. You have to also start asking yourself, why do they censor our comments here if we were not telling you the truth? And that's why we always emphasize that you look for the materials referenced and study them yourself. That way you won't need to watch our videos to understand the slave master's game. And going forward, it says Bono, and in bracket, Bono, which you see is the home of Boko Haram today. The same things they were doing back then. But when you look at them, you will think it's only happening in the north. The target was the Negroes, and still today is the Negroes. And it goes further to say, which appears today in the northeastern corner of the map of Nigeria. Remember, this person was writing in the 60s during that war. And remember, at that time, like during the slave trade, some people's conscience were called into action and they questioned the morality of that law. But like we told you, believe it or not, the slave master, like his brainless foot soldiers, they lack humanity, they lack common sense. If you were to look at our videos, for example, what will you say the Negroes did to them? But you see how they are always interested in censoring the comments that could have opened the eyes of the Negroes. Now, if you think people like this Stacy that is posting here is posting something because she knows what she's talking about, you are mistaken. Those are how their trolls work. They come in to distract everyone, destabilize the flow, and then help the slave master propagate his lies. In the event you have no ideas what happened during that war, you just need to investigate. And remember, it was the same war that made the likes of Steve Jobs abandon Christianity and Islam, because at that time it was very easy to see that both religions worked together. The fighter planes that bombed the hell out of what was Biafra were flown by the Arabs, and the weapons were supplied by the slave masters, and of course the foot soldiers, the slave hunters of old, like the Nigerian army, were the brutal foot soldiers. They unleashed the type of terror never before seen on earth. And remember, that was the only war on earth where children were legitimate targets. And that's why we told you that this pandemic had everything to do with Biafra and Ambazonia. But we leave that apart. Going forward, it says, the positions of Bono and the Biafra make it clear that Thomas Bowen put his kingdoms in the right places. As for Lake Chad, Bowen shows it clearly to the east of Bono in the kingdom of Kauga, and as far from his Biafra as it is from today's Biafra. I was at a loss to understand why Mr. Dawson should accuse me of unworthy motives in a mere matter of cartographical interpretation until I noticed that he writes from the London School of Economics and Political Science, an institution of which one has had a good deal. Well, his method may be political, but it's certainly not scientific. Yours faithfully, A.V.H. Abakuk, Landovery, Kamashia, or whatever. But our interest is for you to see how people change the narrative at that time. Remember, whatever you see the foot soldiers saying, you see people like the Nigerian army today, you notice that the Fulani herdsmen that are massacring people, sacking communities, enjoy the protection of the army. And that should tell you right there that they are one and the same. The only difference between the Nigerian army, the Cameroonian army, and the Fulani herdsmen or Boko Haram is just the uniform. But otherwise, they are all instruments in the hands of the slave masters. But our interest is to show you this so that you can also research things yourself further to understand what may be going on. It's deeper than what they tell you. And remember, the slave masters' media is powered by fake news. so you don't need to rely on them. Conduct your own research. And then to our topic of today. Recall from part one of our series on the Arrow Never Conducted Slave Raids. We looked at the Arrow priests and who they were prior to the slave master's invasion. We also looked at the false claims of Adobe Trisha Mwobani, who claimed, albeit falsely, that her great-grandfather was a Nigerian slave trader or slave hunter, whatever she chose to call it. We also saw how Professor Biko Agozino debunked her false claims. We also saw all the lies around how the slave hunting militia renamed Nigerian Army was established. They claimed it was established in 1960, claimed it was established in 1890s, claimed it was established in 1863, and we already know that the reason and only reason they are lying is because they don't want anyone to know the history of the army as a slave hunting militia. It was behind the sale of all these so-called African Americans you see today. The Negro sale into slavery was done by that army. If you doubt what we're saying, conduct your research. And we saw how the group claiming the Arrow could have raided for slaves or were behind the slave trade also claimed to be Igbos. Remember, those people claiming to be Igbos and insisting that the Arrow were the slave dealers and slave traders, it's like somebody whose father was an armed robber coming to brag that his father was an armed robber. Because the only difference between a slave hunter and an armed robber is that a slave hunter is an armed robber that steals humans and murders humans, while an armed robber is a robber that steals other things apart from humans, even though they may have started doing so now in the same area, like the Nigerian army too. That's all it does. It does not protect anybody. The Cameroonian army does not protect anybody. It's rather a smoke screen, because the slave master had to stop the slave hunters at that time in that mode. But otherwise, till today, the slave master is the biggest sponsor of slavery and slave trade, and of course subjugation of the Negroes, the same way he was a brutal slave hunter back in the days. If you doubt what we're saying, let your research question be, which country was the biggest slave merchant? Then you will understand what we are talking about. And in the event you don't really understand how the slave trade was, how legitimate it was, and how the whole world enjoyed it at that time, especially the slave masters in Europe, in the Middle East and North and South America, you look at something like this Sunday Courier newspaper of Saturday, September 29th, 1894. You see, part of the news it had was about three Negroes lynched. New York, Sunday. Another lynching case is reported from Arkansas. A merchant having been robbed and murdered by three Negroes. Some 300 persons, whites and blacks, took the murderers out of the sheriff's hands and hanged them. So you see how it used to be. It's more elaborate than you are being made to understand unless you pick up the books and read them yourself. And back to our topic of today about the Arrow and how they couldn't have conducted slave raids. We must remember that it was the slave master and his brainless foot soldiers framing them. Normally what they would do is, after doing what they want to do, they look for someone else to blame it on and then use their media preponderance to propagate it as a lie. So that's why you see that some so-called Igbos today still somehow believe that the Arrow priests could have been the ones that sold the slaves. That was the slave master's trick to incite the people against their priests at that time. So let us reference Adventures of an African Slaver being a true account of the life of Captain Theodore Kenneth, trader in gold, ivory and slaves on the coast of Guinea. His own story as told in the year 1854 to Brands Meyer, now edited with an introduction by Malcolm Cowley, and this was published in 1928. And there we are told that, please remember that this is about how the slave master demonized the Negro way of life. At that time, the Negroes were just one people, but with multiple and different languages. They are not the same with the other groups like the Berbers, the Tuaregs, even the Hausas are not Negroes. And it says, when the slender crescent of the November moon was first observed, the king announced that his juju men, or high priest, would make his annual round through the town. During his progress, it is strictly forbidden for any of his subjects to remain out of doors after sunset. Such is the terror with which the priests affect to regard the sacred demon that even the fires are extinguished in their houses. So you notice that this was the subtle ways the slave master demonized everything the Negroes practiced, whatever it was. You need to bear in mind that that was the same thing they did to the arrow. They started with human sacrifices, which we are going to be seeing shortly. And it goes further down to say, towards midnight, the Juju man issues from a sacred gregory bush or grove, the entrance to which is inhibited to all Negroes who do not belong to the religious brotherhood. Now remember, at that time, to ask if the slave master was standing somewhere watching them by midnight or he had stories, these are totally different things, but we just want you to understand that some of the things they even wrote, they did not understand, but they know how to falsely accuse the Negroes, and they understand that game very well, and that was exactly what they did. And it goes further here to say, the king, I imagined, stopped to take a deep swig of the rum which he had just received as a dash or present. Then he continued. Now remember, some of the tricks they played at that time, they could just come to a Negro king, give him a little gift as any visitor would give, and then claim they have paid to come and capture slaves from there, even without telling the king, because sometimes they end up murdering the king. You can look at the number of kingdoms they wiped out from the area to understand what we're saying. Just imagine the Nigerian army, what they are doing today that people's eyes have opened, and compared to what they could have done when people were in the dark. You can imagine today an army will wake up and tell you that asking for freedom means you're a terrorist. That should tell you exactly who they are. They are still the slave hunters. It hasn't changed. So this gives us a little idea here that they had no understanding of what the creator of heaven and earth could have been. They called it superstition, because we'll ultimately show you how they brought the golden calf, which the Negroes somehow today think is the real thing. So it goes further to say, we law is suppose some of we child go bad and we no can sell them, we father must kill them own child, and suppose trade be done, we must kill too much child same way, but we think trade no stop for all we juju men. Please tell us so, for them say you country no can never pass God Almighty. Now remember, this is broken English, so when they are telling you about how they wrote the names of the people that entered the slave ship, you should begin to ask questions. There is no way they could have. If you doubt what we're saying, let one African American that has never visited anywhere outside the US as they usually are, come and let's give him or her one name from any of those communities in that area today, let's say in the southern part of Nigeria, and see if he or she can write it, and then tell us how the slave master could have written even those that were 11 and 10 years old. It's all a lie. Professor Gates and those professors, they are cooking up those things. Those names are fake. And if you doubt what we're saying, just bring out one or two of them too, and you will see that they have no meanings in supposedly the area they came from. And all they are doing it for is so that people can believe it could have been a cell. Remember, at that time, they convinced the whole world that the Negroes were like cattle. You bring them and sell them, they won't even move, which we shall look at in a subsequent video. But going further here, it says, Captain Crowe agreed with him that the British Parliament could never pass God Almighty. The other slaving captains were of the same opinion, and yet for a few years at least, the trade was practically wiped out. 2 months before the British law went into effect, a bill outlawing the slave trade had passed both houses of Congress. The Danish commerce in Negroes, once extensive, had been made illegal in 1802. The Swedes abolished the trade in 1813, the Dutch in the following year. Meanwhile, all these prohibitions were being enforced by the British Navy, which in the last years of the Napoleonic Wars kept watch in every sea. Our interest is one to show you how they turned the whole thing around. Remember, these were the same slave hunters, but you see how they turned it to say that the Negroes were the ones selling it to themselves. Now, if the Negroes were the ones selling it to themselves, why were the laws to stop it being made in their own country? But at least this will give you a little idea of how their things work. You notice that this little debate and discussion here, where the Negro King was trying to tell him that nobody is more than the Almighty Creator of heaven and earth, he has captured his broken English and tried to make it look like the king was saying they must continue to sell. Remember, they tried to make it look like it was a sell. It was never a sell, because if it was a sell, there is no way they could have gotten 400, 500 to fill slave ships. You need to bear that in mind. But then, we want to show you a bit of how they played the trick that made their gullible foot soldiers to believe that the Arrow could have sold the slaves. The only reason you can believe it is if you think it was a sell. If you don't look at it in greater detail, you will think you can be brought out to be sold and you won't run away, because that's how they made it look like, that the Negroes were like cattle. But let's just move forward. So here you see a little idea that they did not know what they were talking about. And it says, these Jujus, who in Africa assume the prerogatives of divinity, are the principles of a religious fraternity who from time immemorial have constituted a secret society for the purpose of sustaining their kings and ruling the people through their superstition. By fear and fanaticism, these brutal priests exact confessions, which is in due time are announced to the public as divinations of the oracle. The king and his chiefs are generally supreme in this brotherhood, and the purity of the sacrificed virgin in the ceremony just described was unquestionably yielded to her brutal prince. Now please remember that we didn't just want to read all of it, find the material and read them yourself. At that time they were accusing them of human sacrifices. They never accused them of being behind the slave trade. This was a later thing and a product of their revisionism, which we shall look at in a subsequent video. But our interest is to show you how they built this thing, and they know that they are brainless future that we buy into it. If you were to understand it better, you will see in a place like Nigeria, where we are looking at Boko Haram as negotiation by violence, which is what it was. But then, you see, suddenly, the moment the slave master returned his brainless foot soldiers to power, one thing they did was to declare a peaceful group for agitating for freedom. They declared them as terrorists. Now, if you ask an average northerner, if you doubt us, try it, he or she is going to tell you that IPOB is a terrorist group. Why? Because that's what the army said. The army was a slave hunting militia. But whatever it says, the people there believe it. Even if they wake up today and claim that you were the one that murdered Jesus, those people in the north will believe it. And that's why they work to keep them poor and illiterate. You need to understand this principle very well. The slave master knows this. All we are telling you here are things the slave master knows very well.